Lord, in this moment, we come to you and lay our lives before you. May we worship this morning and adore you with every fiber of our being. May everything within us cry, "Holy is the Lord, God Almighty, who has a plan for me." Today, Lord, we come together and sing aloud your name in love and trust. We lay down our worries and our thoughts, and we come ready to listen for your glory. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we trust you. Lord, we fix our eyes upon you. Amen.
Jacob wanted to show the world he loved his son, to make it clear that Joseph was the special one. So Jacob,
when you brag about the great coat your dad gave you, your brothers who didn't get a coat get jealous.
Joseph's coat was elegant, the cut was fine, the tasteful style was the ultimate in good design.
When Joseph tried it on, he knew his sheepskin days were gone. Such a stunning coat of many colors, how he loved his coat of many colors. It was red and yellow and green and brown and blue. Joseph's brothers weren't too pleased with what they saw.
We had never liked him all that much before, and now this coat has got a goat. We feel life is unfair.
And when Joseph graced the scene, his brothers turned a
shame. When your brothers get jealous, they plot against you.
Quite the smoothest person in the district.
Such a dazzling coat of many colors. How I love my coat.
colors. It was red and yellow and green and brown and scarlet. In a flash, the brothers changed their plan.
We can!
Let's sell him if we can!
When your brothers plot against you, you get sold to be a slave.
Things look bad for you, hey, what you gonna do? Poor, poor Joseph, what you gonna do? Things look bad for you, hey, what you gonna do?
When you get sold to be a slave, you lose everything, even your great coat.
Tore his coat and flung him in a pit. Poor Joseph, sold to be a slave. Situation's grave, hey, sold to be a slave.
God's black, ochre, peach.
Don't lose everything. Get connected with God. Visit Camarillo United Methodist Church to learn how.
And cream and crimson and silver and rose and azure and lemon and russet and gray.
It is now time for kids' time, so come on up, kids. Louvie, you ready for kids' time?
I'm ready. All right, kids, gobble over. Yeah, whatever.
So I had something really cool for kids' time. And then something else really cool happened, and there was too much cool going on. I forgot to prepare kids' time. So I really don't know what to do anymore. What do you guys suggest I do? Yeah?
Draw pictures
of our families. That's a great idea. Where do we have papers and crayons or something? Somebody help me. What do we do now for kids' times? Oh, Miss Connie's there. You didn't prepare anything? Well, I was hoping you would always bring something.
I have a book I was going to donate to the nursery, but it's...
Let me see that book.
It's not
true.
I mean, it's just about,
yeah,
I don't think it'll work.
Well, let me see it. I mean, it will work better than what I was trying to do. All right, let's try it out. It has a cute picture. Can't be bad.
I don't know. We'll just try and make it work.
All right.
So, maybe you could be Choco. And is there a way maybe they could just magically get the pictures to come up? We'll see what happens. And you're a cute little fella.
This is when she's unprepared.
How about you be the voice of Choco?
Sounds good. It's gonna be a Choco with a heavy cold.
Choco was a little bird who lived all alone. He wished he had a mother. But who could his mother be? One day he set off to find her. First, Choco met Mrs. Giraffe.
Oh, Miss Giraffe! He cried. You are jello, yellow, just like me. Are you my mother?
I'm sorry, sighed Mrs. Giraffe, but I don't have wings like you. Next, Choco met Mrs. Penguin.
Oh, Mrs. Penguin, he cried. You have wings just like me. Are you my mother?
I'm sorry, sighed Mrs. Penguin, but I don't have big round cheeks like you. Then Choco met Mrs. Walrus.
Oh, Mrs. Walrus, he cried. You have big round cheeks just like me. Are you my mother?
Now look, grumped Mrs. Walrus. I don't have striped feet like you, so don't bother me. No matter where Choco searched, he couldn't find a mother who looked just like him. When Choco saw Mrs. Bear picking apples, he knew she couldn't be his mother. Mrs. Bear didn't look like him at all. Choco was so sad, he started to cry.
Mommy, mommy, I need a mommy.
Mrs. Bear came running to see what was the matter. As she listened to Choco's story, she sighed. Oh dear, if you had a mommy, what would she do?
I'm sure she would haul me.
Like this, asked Mrs. Bear, and she held Choco very tight.
Yes, and I'm sure she would kiss me too.
Like this, asked Mrs. Bear, and she lifted Choco and gave him a big kiss.
Yes, and I'm sure she would sing and dance with me to cheer me up.
Like this, asked Mrs. Bear, and they sang and they danced together. When they stopped to rest, Mrs. Bear turned to Choco and said, Choco, maybe I could be your mother.
You?
Choco cried.
But you aren't yellow, and you don't have wings, or big round cheeks, or striped feet like me.
My goodness, said Mrs. Bear, that would make me look very funny. Choco thought it was funny, too. Well, said Mrs. Bear, my other children are waiting for me at home. Why don't you join us for apple pie, Choco? Apple pie sounded wonderful to Choco, so off they went. When they arrived, Mrs. Bear's other children rushed out to greet her. Choco, said Mrs. Bear, meet Hippie, Allie, and Piggy. I am their mother, too. The sweet smell of apple pie and the sound of laughter soon filled Mrs. Bear's home. The end. Luby, we typically close with a prayer, so maybe we'll say a prayer. I'll say a prayer, if that's okay. And then we're going to stay put for one quick second. I understand there's a special presentation, so let us pray. Awesome God, we thank you for our many families, our church family, our youth family, Bells, choir family, Girl Scout family, Boy Scout family. But most of all, we thank you for your family, the family of God, of which we all belong. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Marion Brock, and most of you know I am a soldier angel. I take care of men and women while they're deployed. Well, during this last deployment of the team I had a very special little helper. And I have a presentation today for Mia Kinch from the U.S. Army Special Operations ODA 1325. They were recently stationed in Afghanistan. So during the deployment, I bought some Girl Scout cookies from her for my boys. And she decided on her own that they needed a few extra boxes. So she sent some extra boxes, plus she made some handmade cards to send down to them. They absolutely loved it. So they are totally in love with her. They asked about her all the time. So, but then she did this. As you can see, she decided all on her own that she wanted to make a soldier angel for each and every one of them. So she set out to make at least 20, I'm not quite sure, I know it was at least 20 of these lovely little handmade angels for each one of my guys. They were so impressed and thankful for her kindness that they sent this to me to give to her when they got back to the States. So, this is what they said about her. So it's up on the screen, but I will read it because it's kind of hard to read. So, the angels Mia made were left in Afghanistan. Right before we left, we ran around the place and left them all over the place in hopes that they would pop up over a long period of time and bring a smile to another soldier away from his family. We left them on nightstands, on desks next to computers, in the gym, on the radio, and in the cubbies where everyone keeps all of their body armor and their guns, where they spend time. They brought us a lot of love, so we chose to pass that love along. We figured she would be okay with that, so that the love she showed, the love she showed all of us, gets to grow and expand outward. So this team, they had a very rough deployment. They were very busy, and one of their guys did not make it home. Well, he made it home, but these gestures from her were so amazing. I'm sorry. They helped them through a lot of really hard times, and they really appreciated it. And this was the love that they sent to you, and I hope it helps you to continue to do that for them. So, thank you very much.
Scripture lesson today comes from Psalm 89. Psalm 89 begins on a note of praise and ends with lament. The heart of this psalm recalls God's choice of David as king and God's covenant with him to establish an eternal dynasty. I will sing of your unfailing love, Eternal One, forever. I will speak of your faithfulness to all generations. I will tell how your unfailing love will always stand strong and how your faithfulness is established in the heavens above. You said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I made my servant David this promise. I will establish your dynasty so that you and your descendants will always be secure. Your rule will continue for generations to come.
Thank you.
we come to you today with many different thoughts on our hearts and minds. We come together from different places. We each have our own struggles, our own stories, our own hopes, and our own to-do lists. However, we are gifted this morning with an opportunity to come together within these four walls. In this sanctuary, we are family. We are a faithful, inclusive, unconditionally loving support system which is brought to life by you. Lord, thank you for the blessing of family, for helping us to explore what this word means and to redefine it in your name so that we may speak as you would speak, do as you would do, and love as you would love. Now let us pray as Jesus taught us long ago, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The second reading today comes from Matthew chapter 12, verses 46 through 50. While Jesus was still talking to the crowd, his mother and brothers stood outside, wanting to speak to him. Someone told him, Your mother and brothers are standing outside wanting to speak to you. He replied to him, Who is my mother and who are my brothers? Pointing to his disciples, he said, Here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. The word of God for the people of God.
Our message today is going to be delivered in the form of a short drama. It's called What About Family? And the three actors we have with us this morning are Ethan Skeens, CJ Burgoyne, and Sierra Binney. This is what we learned about What About Family.
All right, so thank you two for meeting with me today. Now, as you know, Youth Sunday is coming up. In fact, it is this morning. And so we need to come up with something for youth service, right? Something that, and the theme is family. So what can we say about family? And I think that this should be fairly easy because all of us have families and we've lived with them throughout all of our lives.
Yeah, we should be experts on this subject.
All right, so what should we say? And I'm going to throw out some ideas. Tell me what you guys think about this. Everyone should have one.
Well, yeah.
You can't live without one.
Well, I think we should talk about the importance of family in our lives. Be pro-family. Families are good.
Except when they're not. I mean, there are a lot of messed up families out there.
Tell me about it. I could give some great examples of messed up families I know, but we won't go there. Not going to give any of my family secrets away.
Yeah. And you know what? I know a guy with some special gifts, and get this, his step-parents made him sleep in a room under the stairs. Like, can you believe that?
You mean Harry Potter? That's a whole different era of dysfunctional families. Fictional families.
Yeah, but there are some pretty dysfunctional families on TV. Just think about The Sopranos, a mob family, Empire. They're in jail half the time. Game of Thrones, they're always killing each other.
You know, The Simpsons, The Griffins from Family Guy, the list goes on.
Rudolph.
I'm sorry. Are you talking about Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, the famed Christmas icon? That Rudolph.
His dad was ashamed of his red nose, and he tried to hide it from everyone. And no one would let him join in any reindeer games.
Like Monopoly.
Literature is full of dysfunctional families, too. Think about Shakespeare. You have Hamlet, whose own brother murdered him to become king, and then married his widow.
And King Lear. Liar, Lair, whatever. You know, now that was a messed up family. I mean, the daughters schemed and fought to get his money and fortune, and spoiler alert, they all ended up dying anyways.
Speaking of dying, then there's Romeo and Juliet. They ended up killing themselves because their warring families wouldn't want them to be together. Drama.
What about the screwed up families in history? Henry VIII? He had 6 wives and he beheaded 2 of them.
Yeah, there are even examples in the Bible, like Cain and Abel. You know, Cain killed Abel because he thought God loved him more. First family on earth, and they were already screwed up, and somehow worse than me and my brother at family gatherings.
And don't forget the story of Jacob's sons. They were so jealous of their brother Joseph because they thought he was the favorite son that they sold him into slavery and pretended he was dead.
Well, this is going to be a really fun, uplifting service, don't you think?
Okay. Let's go back to the Bible. This is our primary source. So, what does the Bible say about families?
Well, here, I found this. Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife as Christ is the head of the church, his body of which he is the Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Oh, I don't think so.
Jeez, when was this written? The Dark Ages?
I mean, kinda.
Well, here's another one. If a man has a stubborn and rebellious son who will not obey the voice of his father or the voice of his mother, and who, when they have chastened him, will not heed them, then his father and mother shall take hold of him and bring him out to the elders of his city, to the gate of his city, and they shall say to the elders, "This son of ours is stubborn and rebellious. He will not obey our voice. He is glutton and drunkard." Then all the men of the city shall stone him to death with stones. Oh my gosh. I can't believe the Bible says you can kill your kid for being stubborn. I'm in trouble.
Okay. On the other hand, the Bible also does say, "Husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband." So that one's more mutual, to love and respect one another.
Well, that does sound better. And I found this one about children. "Fathers, do not provoke your child to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord." That's better. No killing involved. But they were real big on discipline in those days, huh?
I mean, I guess you just kind of have to read it in context. You know, it was a very different culture back in those days. Very violent and dangerous. You know, maybe disciplining your child was just a way to show them love, to make sure that they grew up in rules and order and not just become whatever celebrities in rehab nowadays.
You know, now that I think about it, a time out and being grounded for a couple days doesn't sound too bad.
Yeah, and telling husbands to love their wives as themselves was a way of making sure they were not mistreating their wives. Equal rights would come much later.
So husbands are supposed to love their wives and presumably their children. Well, what does the Bible say about love?
Well, there is this very famous verse from Corinthians. "If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and cannot fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing."
Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails.
And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Well, now that's just beautiful. This is a Bible verse I can embrace.
So, are we supposed to love our family? Are they supposed to love us? Is that all?
Well, see, I was wondering if Jesus had anything to say about family, and I found this. If anyone comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and child, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple, which I guess means that we're actually supposed to hate our families.
What? That's really bleak. What did I say about getting dark and depressing?
Wait, there's a footnote here. Jesus is testifying in a culture that was profoundly familial or tribal. I think we can relate to that today. Our society's become very tribal. My tribe, group, right or wrong. We're better than your tribe. It goes on to say that Jesus wanted to break people of their tribalism to establish a much more inclusive understanding of family rather than just bloodlines. Everybody is eligible to be part of the family based on being a child of God.
Here's more on that same idea. Jesus was talking to a crowd and someone told him, "Your mother and brothers are standing outside wanting to speak to you." He replied to them, "Who is my mother and who are my brothers?" Pointing to his disciples, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother, sister, and mother." So again, your family is more than just the people you're related to. That maybe we are one big family of God.
Hold on, when you say family of God, do you mean that only Christians can be part of the family, or what's going on there?
No, I don't think it means that all. I think it applies to everyone, all faiths, all colors, genders, ethnic groups.
I think the Bible definition of family is too narrow. I mean, is family just a husband, a wife, and kids? What about step-parents? Half-siblings? I mean, I have a lot of friends who don't live in a stereotypical family. What about friends you think of as family?
What about families that have two mothers or two fathers?
Or families with only a single parent?
Okay, so what we're saying here is that there's no one set definition of family.
Well, I think when you love someone a whole awful lot, they become your family.
Okay, so let's recap. Number one, families are good, except when they're dysfunctional.
I think you missed the point. Families are good in spite of being dysfunctional. That we may not be perfect, but we are there for each other and forgive each other.
Okay, that's better. And number two, love your family.
And number three, your family's basically everyone.
Okay, I'm sorry. When you say everyone, does that include those dirty, dishonest Democrats?
No, even the lying Republicans?
Yeah, you guys, I think calling people names is not being loving. And yes, you need to love even the people that don't agree with you.
You know, the more I learn about family, the more I realize how hard this lesson is.
Hey, we never said being a family was easy.
Accept these humble gifts, we pray, and in our hearts forever stay. With these gifts, may you bring peace, that suffering, want, and war may cease. Amen.
As I went down to the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, brothers, let's go down, come on down, come on, brothers, let's go down, down to the river to pray. As I went down to the river to
We dedicate this money, Lord, for the work of the church, and we ask you to use all that we have and all that we are in your service. Amen.
I'd like to join with you in thanking our youth for being our worship leaders today. I am very privileged and very proud to be the youth leader here. They're a great group of kids. You should be very proud. And thank you for bringing up such a great group. If you have checked your watches lately, you know that it is 10 after 10. You are welcome. Because we're finishing a little early, I hope that you will sit down and listen to our postlude. We have Sierra Binney doing our postlude this morning. Sierra's like, shoot, I was hoping she wouldn't make them stay. Thank you, everybody.